Hello, I'm Simon Owens, and you're listening to The Business of Content, a podcast about how publishers create, distribute, and monetize their digital content. In this episode, we're discussing a family-owned newspaper chain that pivoted to digital subscriptions. The last 15 years have not been kind to the local news industry, with thousands of newspapers either reducing staff or closing down entirely. But not all newspapers have been affected equally, and some of the hardest hit chains were owned by hedge funds and private equity firms that had no actual interest in investing in journalism. Family-owned newspapers seem to have fared better, and that seems to be the case for Forum Communications, a chain of newspapers and other media outlets situated in the Midwest. A few years ago, the company's newspapers rolled out a digital subscription model, and so far it seems to be performing above expectations. I recently interviewed Stephanie Schroeder, Forum's Chief Digital Marketing Officer, about the gargantuan amount of work that went into this pivot and what strategies resulted in the most success. Before we jump into the interview, I want to talk about a recent article I published in my newsletter. I went deep on a company called Blockworks Group. It started out as a cryptocurrency events company before launching a thriving podcast network that generates millions of dollars in revenue. Both founders walk me through how they grew the business and their plans to build a crypto-focused news organization. There's only one way to read analysis like this, and it's by subscribing to my Substack newsletter. Go to simonowens.substack.com. That's simonowens.substack.com. Or just Google the words Simon Owens and newsletter. Okay, on to my interview with Stephanie. Hey, Stephanie, thanks for joining us.
Yeah, thanks so much for having me, Simon.
So you work for a media chain called Forum Communications. Tell me a little bit about that. Like, where is it? What kind of media properties does it own? And how long has it been around?
So Forum Communications is a family-owned media company. We've been around since 1878. We're actually located in the upper Midwest. So we have properties in North Dakota, South Dakota, Wisconsin, and Minnesota. Our headquarters is in Fargo, North Dakota. And we have 20 plus print and digital news brands all throughout the Midwest, as well as some broadcast and commercial print divisions as well.
And that's like completely family owned, as opposed to, you know, some of these larger chains that are owned by private equity. Like, this is like a long time family owned newspaper. Well, it's not just newspapers, but mainly a newspaper chain.
That's exactly right. It's a sixth generation family owned media company. So it's been owned or operated by family all throughout its ownership.
So you were brought in as its first chief digital marketing officer, correct? Like, why did they build that role for you?
Yeah, that's correct. So a while back, a bunch of executives were sitting around a table and really talking about what the future of the company looked like. And they knew that they needed to create a digital subscription model, but they weren't exactly sure where to begin. And so they brought in a consultant who used to work at the New York Times, and she came in and started to give some advice. And she said, well, first off, where's your marketing department? And they all sort of looked around the room at each other and they said, well, we don't have one. And she's like, well, that's step one. So they followed her advice and they posted a role for a chief digital marketing officer. And that's kind of where my role came to be.
And what was your background? Like, you didn't work at newspapers before, did you?
No, this was completely new for me. So I previously worked in the healthcare benefits space, but I was in marketing there. I was a VP of marketing for a local healthcare benefits company. And really just took a leap of faith after meeting with the people at the Forum Communications office and really loved what I heard about what they wanted to do and decided to really switch gears with my career. And it was a really great decision.
And basically kind of, you know, even though you weren't in media, this was about like kind of productizing and selling something directly to consumers. So it sort of like fit within, still within your purview of what you knew about, right?
Exactly. So my previous role prior to coming to Forum Communications was all about selling a product to consumers. And so this really isn't all that different. The product just changed. And what I really like about it is I find it a little bit more mission driven, a little bit more purposeful, and I can really get behind the why of what we're doing. And that's always really appealed to me.
Tell me about your first few months in the role. Like, how did you get the lay of the land and begin building the strategy for the expansion into the digital subscriptions?
So I would say the first few months was really like drinking out of a fire hose, as they say. It was being thrown into a lot of new things that I didn't know a whole lot about. And so I was really guided by just what I did know to be true, which is everything about how to market something to consumers. And the biggest challenge there is we had previously been giving our content away for free online. And now we were heading to this model where we weren't going to be doing that anymore. And so the biggest thing to figure out was how can you move from giving away your content for free to starting to ask people to pay for that content? And we decided that the biggest strategy there is we need to invest in content and we need to invest in our products. And so that's what we did.
And media is kind of like a really weird industry that's not like a lot of other industries in the sense that like the people who are building the core product, which is the editorial, are kind of weirdly separated from the business side in different ways. And there were all kinds of like different ethics rules and different stuff like that. Like, did you feel like you needed to get educated on like how a media company works as opposed to like a pure consumer, you know, product company?
I did. There was a little bit of friction at first, just, you know, with some of the decisions that you have to make about, for instance, what you put behind the paywall. You know, when there's an extreme community safety story, how do you handle that? From an ethical standpoint, you want people to be able to access that kind of content. And so a big part of the early days of my role was sitting down with people in the newsroom and in our editorial division and just understanding how they operate and what decisions they have to make, and then how does the paywall change any of that, if it does.
So what are some of the major hurdles that a legacy newspaper chain has to consider that a brand new digital site, like, you know, the one that I run, like, doesn't have to think about? Like, you had to figure out how to take these print subscribers and these legacy systems and combine them with a paywall, which is, from a logistical standpoint, that's like pretty difficult to do, right?
It is quite difficult. In fact, I would say the most challenging piece of all was just the technology component of everything. So we had, like you said, legacy systems, and then we needed to integrate that with all of these other systems that were newer. So the email platform, the paywall platform, obviously, and so many other pieces. And when we were grappling with all of that, we actually secured help from another consultant who used to work at NASA. And he's a really bright guy, really has a good hand on technology. And he helped us draw out this integration map. And he's drawing all these lines from one platform to another. And it just looks like this giant, messy web on a sheet of paper. And he looks up at all of us and he says, "This is complicated." And you just know if the guy from NASA thinks it's complicated, it's complicated. And so that was by far just the most challenging part. And it's never ending. I mean, every time we add a new system, it's another integration. And that's the part that really keeps us up at night sometimes.
And did you have to overhaul the whole website? Or was there just like a way to just take some kind of membership or subscription platform and just put it over the website?
I wouldn't say we had to overhaul the website, but we made the decision that we wanted to, because, again, we were going from this state of giving away our content for free to suddenly asking people to pay for a product that we weren't previously asking them to pay for. And so we wanted to make sure that we were improving that product and improving the discoverability of the content that people wanted. And so we decided to, before even beginning to implement the paywall, create a plan for redesigning all of our network of news sites. So that was sort of step one. And then from there, we felt good about launching that paywall on top of them.
And so prior to launching, I'm guessing that you were kind of projecting conceivable conversion rates. Like, how quickly did you hope to acquire new digital subscribers to where it would make up a significant part of your business, at least prior to launching?
We really didn't know what exactly to expect. You know, we had talked to others in the space and they had shared stories of pretty decent growth in the first few months, but pretty low expectations overall, just as you grapple with all of the challenges of implementing a new model like this. And so we just sort of set an arbitrary goal of 10,000 digital subscribers in the first year. It wasn't really super scientific. We just felt like that seemed like a reasonable goal for our entire network of sites. And then we wound up tripling that in the first year. And so we we either really underestimated our goal or we really did surprisingly well for what we set out to do. But I'm going to hope it's the second one.
Yeah. So 10,000 subscribers across like 20 different newspapers. That seems like a reasonable goal that you can meet, but you guys tripled it. We'll get into the tripling part in a little bit. So tell me about the rollout of the digital paywall. Like, when did it happen? And then how did you kind of educate your audience about it, like prior to it launching?
Sure. So as I said, the implementation with all of the technical integrations was the hardest part. So we started in October of 2018, and implementing took us about 10 months. We launched our first paywall on July 16th, 2019. Still remember the day because it's one that you kind of gets burned in your memory. But when we launched our first paywall in July of 2019, that was just on one site. So that was actually even just to 5% of our audience. We didn't go live for everybody all at once because we really wanted to get confidence in how the technology was working. And then we gradually rolled it out to 100% of the audience on that particular site. And then beyond that, we had to create this incremental rollout plan for our other news sites, and that took another 6 months. So it was a good year to a year and a half of just implementation work.
And were you like publishing articles or any like anything just saying, hey, this is coming? Or did people just kind of wake up one day and notice there was a paywall waiting for them when they tried to access the content?
Yep. So we did warn people that we were shifting to this new model. We really discussed it as moving from a subscription to a membership. So previously, our print subscribers, they had access to the printed newspaper, and anybody could go online and get access to our content. And now we were really talking about a membership. We were giving the people who were already subscribed access to a lot of things that other people who were not subscribed wouldn't have access to. Unlimited content, access to our e-paper, which is the digital replica of our print paper, access to our historical archives, and even some member events and some discounts as well. And so that's really how we framed it for our existing subscribers. And for our digital readers, a lot of them were maybe a little bit surprised. You know, let people know that it was coming, but unless they were visiting our site all the time to see that news, it was really the first time that they were ever stopped from reading a piece of content that they probably noticed that change.
And what does it cost to subscribe? And like, do you get access to all your local newspapers for that subscription?
Yep. It's currently $100 a year or $9.99 a month. So you do save a little bit if you pay annually, but that grants you access to our entire network of news sites. So you can use your same set of login credentials across all of the sites in the upper Midwest that are owned by Form Communications.
Tell me about how you structure your paywall and when are people hitting it?
So currently we have a hard registration wall, which means anytime anyone clicks on anything, with maybe a couple exceptions, they will be asked to register. Registration is completely free. So once they register, they'll get an additional 4 articles. At that point, you know, as they're clicking through these 4 articles, they'll be encouraged to subscribe. And once they've used up their 4th article in a 30-day period, they will be asked to subscribe and won't be able to keep reading until they do. That meter does reset, obviously, after the 30-day period, so they can come back and enjoy more content if they're more of a casual drive-by reader.
Yeah, more and more newspapers and publications are launching these hard registration walls. The reasoning being that because people are accessing on different browsers, on different devices, using incognito mode, publishers are kind of finally just throwing up their hands and saying like 100% of people have to be registered and logged in, and that way we can more easily track what, you know, people are reading and more easily guess when they are about ready to hit the paywall. Is there like a trade-off there? Because like obviously you're restricting access to content by putting in like a hard registration wall. Like did you see any kind of major hit to your traffic, or were people willing to actually, you know, register?
In general, I think because we made the benefit pretty clear for the readers, they haven't been too opposed to registering. They know it's free. It's something that they can easily do. We have social logins, so it's not something they even really have to do much typing for. So our traffic has stayed steady and our registrations have skyrocketed. And we really believe that that benefits the reader too, because once we know their information, we're able to serve up more of that content that they're really interested in and just curate their experience a little better.
And I'm guessing when they register, you auto enroll them in like a newsletter or something like that, in which case that'll help you in terms of long-term conversion, because then not only are you getting that reader then, but you're getting them at least somewhat in the long term because you're able to hit them with a newsletter every single morning going forward, right?
Yeah, we do give them the option. We don't auto sign them up, but we ask them if they'd like to be signed up at the point of registration. And for the most part, people are very interested in our newsletters. So most people do choose that.
And over the past 2 years, as you've, you know, had this paywall going, you've been collecting data, how have you tweaked the paywall over time?
Well, when we launched, we decided to set our meter at 10 free articles. And this was actually prior to launch during the implementation. And as we were going through this 10-month plus long process, we decided that that needed to probably lower to something closer to 6 free articles, because we certainly wanted people to see the value in the content and become engaged on our sites. But we also wanted to encourage them to subscribe. And we felt like 10 was just a little bit too high for accomplishing that. So we have kind of whittled that down over time. But we've also gotten a lot more strategic about how we deploy the paywall. So experimenting with things that are just a little bit more dynamic, understanding if a reader is more of a casual reader or more of a loyal reader who comes back every single day. And then also experimenting with more content-specific messaging as well. We found that when you can really show the value of the content that you provide in your paywall messaging, you're more likely to convert versus just using generic messages across the board.
So you will, like, you know, for example, if someone is reading a restaurant review, that might count less towards the paywall than someone who's reading a government, something about the Board of Supervisors meeting or something like that, who might, because they're digging deeper into their local government, might be more likely to convert to a paid subscription quicker. Like, are you talking about that from a dynamic paywall point of view?
That's where we want to get to. We haven't quite gotten that sophisticated yet, but we are serving up messaging that's a little bit more relevant to the content the user is reading. So if I click on a history article, I might see more of a message that says something like, "For all of your history news, subscribe today." That's just a generic example, but we try and cater that messaging to make sure people understand they're subscribing to get the value of the specific content that they're interested in, versus just a message that says support local news and subscribe today.
You mentioned that one single subscription gets you access to all your newspapers. Where are you seeing that crossover audience and interest between where they get the value of having access to all those newspapers?
I think that people aren't super interested necessarily in the hyper local news of our other properties, but they are interested in the regional feature type coverage. So we've actually deployed a bit of a mini publisher model, taking a page out of the Table Stakes book. And we've honed in on a few different content types that we believe our readers will be really interested in, regardless of their location. So regionally, topics like healthcare, outdoors, weather, and hockey are things that really do well across the board. And we've really tried to hone in on those content categories to get more regional interest.
And so with hockey, it's like, you know, because the teams are traveling and playing each other, that's what's driving the crossover.
Yeah, exactly. And a large number of our properties are right in Minnesota. And so Minnesota is a pretty hockey fiend state. And really, regardless of where you are city-wise, I think you kind of care about most of those teams, regardless of where you reside.
What's your biggest drivers of conversions? I'd imagine newsletters play a big part in that.
Newsletters are by far our highest converting channel. So we actually just recently have gotten a little more sophisticated with our ability to track where our conversions are coming from. And for a while, we were just sort of spray and pray, you know, hoping that the types of tactics that we were doing were leading to conversions. And now we can really see exactly where everybody's coming from. And when we looked at that data for the first time, we were stunned to see that 60% of our conversions come from our newsletters. They might you know, have seen an ad or something that brought them to the newsletter and then the newsletter converted them, but in some way they are interacting with their newsletters on their path to subscription. And that was a much higher number than we ever could have imagined.
What's your newsletter strategy? Like, is it just auto generating a list of headlines every day, or do you have like actual editors who are curating them?
We have a mix of both. So when we first started out, we primarily had RSS feed automated newsletters. And then we started to explore a little bit with personalizing those newsletters so that the newsletter I get in my inbox might look a little bit different than the one that you get in your inbox based on the content that we both engage with on the site. And most recently, we've deployed curated newsletters that are crafted by editors in each of our markets. And these have been wildly successful, I think, just because people really appreciate that human connection. You know, we've seen open rates as high as 80% on the curated newsletters compared to maybe more like 40 to 50% in our automated newsletters. And I really just think that's because, you know, when you go to a news site and you click on a story, you know that somebody wrote that story, but it still doesn't feel like it was written for you. But when you open a newsletter in your inbox and somebody's writing snippets of those stories and it's in your inbox, it does feel a little bit like that person wrote it for you. And so I think people really are appreciating that style of newsletter.
Do you guys have comment sections on your articles?
We do not, but we have been grappling with that a little bit recently and deciding whether that's somewhere we want to go. You know, obviously we have commenting enabled on our social channels, and sometimes that can get a little bit dicey. But it is just another place for people to engage and share their opinions about the content. And it's all about creating a community. And so it is something we've been discussing, but we're a little bit torn at the moment.
Yeah, I mean, I've seen evidence that rolling out a comment section in conjunction with a subscription, paid subscription, it A, creates a lot of benefits for the subscribers, but B, it also generates like really good discussion because it weeds out a lot of the drive-by trolls. It's like a lot easier to control because everybody's registered and a lot of them are paying subscribers, and paying subscribers generally tend to be more engaged and polite. Not to say that there wouldn't be any kind of moderation needed, but like that there's generally a higher quality discussion, and it creates like a sense of community for the people who are subscribing.
You know, closest thing we've done to allowing comments is every week in our Fargo market, our editor has what he calls his Chat with Matt series. And so it's a live chat over the noon hour where he lets readers come on and ask him any questions that are on their mind. Sometimes they ask, you know, about a technical problem that they've encountered while on our site. Sometimes they ask why we didn't cover a certain story or why we covered a story a certain way. People ask anything, and anything is fair game. And so it's been an interesting way to watch readers interact with one another, but also interact with our newsroom as well.
Have you guys been experimenting with podcasts at all? I've been keeping my eye out for local podcast successes, but I haven't found very many.
We have. We actually just recently, it's been maybe a month, we launched what's called In For a Minute. And we've launched similar minute podcasts in a few of our markets, but it's just a daily 2 to 3 minute summary of the biggest news that's going on that day. People can watch it on their commute on the way to work. They can pull it up on their lunch break, just get a quick summary. And it's also available on devices like Amazon Alexa. And so it's still very early stages, but we saw 1,000 signups already in just, you know, over a month. So I think people are definitely interested in it.
Is that distributed on podcast apps?
It is. Yep. It's available on Spotify. And I think you can find it pretty much in all the places where you typically would go to find your podcasts.
So like, how is your marketing team distributed? Do you have people at all the individual newspapers, or is it all at kind of like a central location?
We are fully centralized. So our marketing department serves all 20 plus of our news brands. And we have people kind of in a variety of different specialties. We have some people focusing on newsletters. We have someone that really just dives in and manages our paywall configuration. And then we have a couple designers and a copywriter as well. So we are that centralized department that serves the entire engine of our news brand promotion.
What about social media? Like, if a new article goes live, is someone on your team the one who's like tweeting out the copy and putting it on Facebook and different stuff like that?
We coordinate with our editorial department on that. So we have a actually separate department called our engagement hub, and they use an automated tool called Social Flow that pushes content out for all of our news brands. And then what we do in marketing is we monitor the analytics and see which content is really performing well in terms of engagement. And then we boost that content to just give it a little bit extra oomph.
And how much are you communicating with the editors, sharing insights, different stuff like that?
We are getting better at that. I think historically, you know, we are still early on in our digital subscription journey. So we haven't had access to a lot of the data up until very recently. And so now that we're getting access to a lot of the metrics that we need and the metrics that will tell us, you know, what's working and what's not, we're really engaging with our editors and our publishers at each location a lot more regularly to discuss those metrics and really more so what those metrics mean for them.
So tell me about how successful the paywall has been. I think earlier you mentioned that you are three times over what your initial benchmarks are. I mean, what does that tell you about the choice to pivot to subscriptions and what that means for the future of the company?
Yeah, you know, I think it's been more successful, at least in the first year, than any of us would have imagined. So that's been really promising. And I think especially just with the past year that we've all had, our communities have really shown us that they value community journalism, and they don't want that to go away. And they recognize that the mechanism for delivery of that news is changing a little bit. And so I think we've seen a lot of success, you know, in part because of the time that we're living in where news is more important than ever. But also just we had the benefit of not being one of the first ones to really do this. So people are getting a little more accustomed to this subscription world, and we're definitely benefiting from that.
And a lot of these like struggling newspaper chains you hear about, like Gannett and, you know, the Tribune Company and others like that, they're, you know, owned by private equity or hedge funds and other large kind of corporate interests. What do you think your success says about family operated newspaper chains and like in the way that they can drive innovation and invest in news?
Yeah, you know, I think that the family ownership is a huge part of our success. And I mean, part of it is the Marcille family that owns Form Communications just really believes deeply in this business, and they care about the people within the business. And I think they know that to run a successful content business, you can't slash the content resources. You have to invest in content, because at the end of the day, that's what we're selling. And so they've made a really conscious decision to invest in the content side of the business, while companies, you know, all throughout the US that are unfortunately not seeing as much success, they're deciding to slash their content resources. And that's just, when you're in the business of content, you just can't do that.
How optimistic are you on the growth of local news over the last decade? Like, there are some people who think that it's on this kind of permanent decline. I happen to think it's kind of in this kind of like market correction where some legacy newspapers are kind of failing, but other innovators are finding new ways to monetize and new ways to expand. Where do you kind of fall on that spectrum?
I would say I'm definitely the glass is half full versus half empty. I feel like people are always going to have a need for news. And as I mentioned, this past year has shown us that more than ever. I think the key, though, is you can't just produce content in the same way that you've always produced content. The way that people are consuming content is dramatically changing. And I think the people who are going to be the most successful are the people who evolve with their audiences, and not the people who just keep doing things the way they've always done them.
Okay, Stephanie, those are all the questions I had for you. Where can people find you online?
You can find us at formcom.com. That's our corporate site. And then we also have a variety of news publications across the upper Midwest as well. And you can find all of those brands at formcom.com.
Okay, this is a lot of fun. Thanks for joining me.
Yeah, thanks so much for having me, Simon.
Okay, thanks for joining us. I'm actually on the lookout for new guests for this podcast. So if you do interesting stuff in digital content, whether you're a full-time YouTuber, a media executive, or run a cool niche newsletter, definitely reach out. My email address is simonowens@gmail.com. Okay, see you next week.